And when the scripture speaks about fruit flowing out of our lives, it's that which feeds hungry people, the people who are hungry for our love, hungry to experience the peace within us that will spread out to them as being with somebody who's at peace, Dad.
Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my son shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Verse 2, for me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will, but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine.
How marvelous! How wonderful!
In pity, angels beheld him and came from the world of light to comfort him in the sorrows he bore for my soul and mine.
He took my sins.
He took my sins and my sorrows. How marvelous, how wonderful that my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful is my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
This is your final boarding call for Israel 2016. Don't miss out on this amazing experience. Reserve your place now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family on a trip of a lifetime. This is your last chance to reserve your spot now. For November 17th to the 27th, 2016. Visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. That's 1-877-465-3442.
Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time.
I'm going to read to you from Ezekiel chapter 47. We looked into a little bit of Ezekiel's vision of a temple that occupies the last 9 chapters of the book of Ezekiel. It's a temple that has never yet existed, but as I pointed out to you yesterday, we can understand as a picture of the temple occupied by the Holy Spirit, which is the temple of your bodies, my body, as we receive him into our lives. And there are many rich things in these 9 chapters. And I selected just something we talked about yesterday, what went on at the heart of the temple. This morning, I want to talk about what went on outside of the temple as a result of what was happening in the heart of the temple. As a picture of what is going to happen through our lives as we yield them to Jesus Christ and we allow him to do his work in us and we allow ourselves to commune with him and fellowship with him and meet with him. Let me read chapter 47. I'll read the first 12 verses. The man brought me back to the entrance of the temple, and I saw water coming out from under the threshold of the temple towards the east, for the temple faced east. The water was coming down from under the south side of the temple, south of the altar. He then brought me out to the north gate and led me around the outside to the outer gate facing east, and the water was flowing from the south side. As the man went eastward with a measuring line in his hand, he measured off 1,000 cubits, then led me through water that was ankle deep. He measured off another 1,000 cubits and led me through water that was knee deep. He measured off another 1,000 and led me through water that was up to the waist. He measured off another 1,000, but now it was a river that I could not cross because the water had risen and was deep enough to swim in, a river that no one could cross. And he asked me, "Son of man, do you see this?" Then he led me back to the bank of the river. When I arrived there, I saw a great number of trees on each side of the river. He said to me, "This water flows toward the eastern region and goes down into the Arabah, where it enters the sea. When it empties into the sea, the water there becomes fresh. Swarms of living creatures will live wherever the river flows. There'll be a large number of fish because this water flows there and makes the salt water fresh. So where the river flows, everything will live. Fishermen will stand along the shore from Engedi to Eneglem. There'll be places for spreading nets. The fish will be of many kinds, like the fish of the Great Sea, that's the Mediterranean Sea. But the swamps and marshes will not become fresh. They'll be left for salt. Fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both sides of the river. Their leaves will not wither, nor will their fruit fail. Every month they will bear, because the water from the sanctuary flows to them. Their fruit will serve for food, and their leaves for healing. Let me just remind you of the context in which Hilary and I together are speaking over these 2 days. On the road to Emmaus, when Jesus drew alongside those two discouraged, disappointed, defeated disciples, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. His message to them was, you will never understand these Old Testament scriptures as we know them today. They were just the only scriptures they had, of course, in Jesus' day. You'll never understand these scriptures until you understand them in the light of me. That Christ is the code by which we can go back through the Old Testament and interpret all the wonderful meanings and significance of all the many details that are contained there. And we began to look at the temple as being the central building in the city of Jerusalem after Solomon had constructed it during his reign. Prior to that, there'd been the tabernacle that Moses had constructed in the wilderness. And then when Joshua brought them into Canaan, they set up the tabernacle in Shiloh. In the course of time, they replaced that, which was a temporary building, with a permanent temple. Probably the old tabernacle blew away in a gale one day, and so they built a permanent structure, that temple. It was destroyed, as we have heard on the journeying, and I mentioned it yesterday, when the Babylonians came in and took the remaining people of Judah into exile, destroyed the city of Jerusalem, destroyed the temple. Ezra then came back when the Persians had occupied the Babylonian territory and they allowed some of their captivated people to return to their homelands. And Ezra came back and began to rebuild the temple. And Nehemiah came back and built the city walls. And then Herod, 19 BC, extended it and built what we see today as the Temple Mount, as a flat level surface for the temple of God to be present in. But then when Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. And at that moment, the curtain which divided the Holy of Holies in the temple from the holy place, which was the rest of the temple, was torn from top to the bottom. The significance being that had been the place where God's presence was, but now God had broken out. He was changing his address. No longer living in the temple located in Jerusalem. But as we discover in the New Testament, as Paul said, that you are God's temple in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 17, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? 2 Corinthians 6, 16. For we are the temple of the living God. And Ezekiel's vision, which gives us much more detail than we have even about Solomon's temple, even though it has physically never existed, and there are those who see it as a prophecy that is yet to be fulfilled, but I prefer to see it in the light of what the New Testament teaches us as a physical portrayal of that spiritual truth that is to characterize every genuine Christian who lives in fellowship with God, is indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and whose body and life has become the temple of God, the holy place where God himself lives by his Spirit. And the central key to this temple that I pointed out to you yesterday was that when in chapter 43, the Spirit lifted me up and brought me into the inner court, the glory of the Lord filled the temple. The glory of God, you remember, is the presence of God exhibiting the character of God. And while the man was standing beside me, says Ezekiel, I heard someone speak to me from within the temple. He said, Son of man, this is the place of my throne. This is where I'm king. And this is the place of the soles of my feet. That's an expression that reoccurs in the Old Testament. Wherever you place the soles of your feet, that place will be yours. In other words, this is where I'm king, and this is where I have subjugated the enemy and where I have occupied the territory. That's a picture of the relationship we are to enjoy with the Lord Jesus Christ, where he is king within our lives, his kingdom is within us, and where he has placed all things under his feet, and as a consequence, the glory of God, which we by nature have sinned and come short of the glory of God, is restored into our experience. Christ in you is your hope of glory. And the glory of God is restored into our lives. That's what we talked about yesterday to just provide the necessary setting for what I want to talk about this morning, which is in chapter 47, Ezekiel has gone through other details which we won't be looking at. And now he's taken outside the temple, and there is a river flowing out from the south side of the temple. He doesn't call it a river at first. He says, I saw water coming out from under the threshold of the temple. The image that gives me in my mind's eye is like a leak, you know, like a burst pipe. You know, there's water coming out. It's like a trickle. And then this man takes a measuring line and measures off 1,000 cubits. Now, as I understand it, that's about 500 meters. And then he stepped into the water and it was ankle deep. He said, have you noticed this? And then he took him another 500 meters and he stepped into the water. It was knee deep. Have you seen this? Then he took him another 500 meters, stepped into the water. It was up to the waist. Another 500 meters, and it was too deep to stand in. It was deeper than the man. And also, it was too wide at this stage to cross it. And he says, no one could cross. This river flowing out of the temple, the place where God was, where he was on the throne, where things were under his feet, the further it went, the deeper it got, and the wider it got. If we see this temple as a picture of Christian experience, human experience that God intends for each of us, it is beautifully described by Jesus in John 7, verse 37. He was in the temple courts at the time, and he said this, or at least John writes this, on the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow out from within him. As says Jesus, if you're thirsty, and every man, woman, boy, and girl who is detached from God will have within them a deep thirst. They will try to quench in a multitude of ways, but they'll always come back thirsty, like the woman of Samaria. You remember that story? Always thirsty. And Jesus said, if you will take this water I offer, you'll never thirst again. But you are so thirsty, you've been married 5 times. You've given up on marriage. You're living with a man you're not married to. You know, everybody has ostracized you because you're trying to satisfy a thirst. That's not wrong to try and satisfy a thirst. That's very natural. But you're drinking the wrong stuff. But if you take what I offer, you'll never thirst again. Now said Jesus, if you're thirsty, come to me. Come to me. And whoever believes in me, meaning whoever will place their trust in me, what will happen is this. Not only will their thirst be quenched, but out of their hearts, he said, will flow a river of living water that is going to bring benefit and life to other people. And John adds an editorial comment when he wrote this gospel, and he says, by this, he meant the Spirit whom those who believed in him were later to receive. John says, I want you to understand, he's talking about the Holy Spirit, who's not going to just come into our lives to meet that deep need. He's going to flow out of our lives and bring benefit and blessing to other people. Andrew Murray, whose writings I recommend to you in his book, The Full Blessing of Pentecost, which I have here with me on this journey, he writes, in our pursuit of a life of God's fullness, we'll find the sum of Christ's teaching in these words here in John 7. Come to me and drink. Out of your heart will flow a river of living water. You see, what God does in us is designed also to flow through us, to enrich others. In fact, the evidence of what God is doing in us is most accurately seen in what God is doing through us, in bringing benefit and life to other people. You can't fake that. It has to be the original, genuine article. Now, the interesting thing about this picture in Ezekiel 47 is that at its source, it doesn't seem like very much. It looks like a leak coming out under the south side of the temple initially, 500 meters down the stream. It's ankle deep, 500 meters more, knee deep, 500 meters more, up to the waist, 500 meters more. It's so deep you can't wade through it, and it's become so wide you can't cross it. And I love that picture because it means actually that you are the last person to see what God is really doing through your life. You just see the trickle and you think, you know, it's not very much. But you can be sure that if we are living in a relationship with God that is living and fresh, that out of our lives, as the stream moves further afield, where you no longer have the opportunity to see it and measure it, God will be doing things that are deep and wide. That's the picture that he gives. And then he says in verse 6, he asked me, Son of man, do you see this? And let me read you what then happens. Second part of verse 6. Then he led me back to the bank of the river. When I arrived there, I saw a great number of trees on each side of the river. He said to me, this water flows towards the eastern region and goes down into the Arabah. Now that is the Jordan Valley, where it enters the sea, that being the Dead Sea. And you have been to the Dead Sea a couple of days ago, but look at what happens. When it empties into the Dead Sea, the water there becomes fresh. Swarms of living creatures will live wherever the river flows. There'll be a large number of fish because this water flows there and makes the salt water fresh. So everything will live. Down in verse 12, fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both sides of the river. Their leaves will not wither nor their fruit fail. Every month they'll bear fruit. I think this is a beautiful picture. This river brings three qualities with it. It brings freshness, it brings life, it brings fruit. I think those are three beautiful portrayals of what God wants to do in our lives as well. First of all, it brought freshness. When emptied into the sea, it says, the water there becomes fresh. Now, down at the Dead Sea, you will know that the water of the Dead Sea is stagnant. Nothing lives there. That's why it's called the Dead Sea. It's also known as the Salt Sea. It's the lowest place on earth. Nothing can flow out. The only exit of the inflowing water is by evaporation. And of course, the dilemma right now is that the rate of evaporation is greater than the rate of input of the water coming down the Jordan, because everybody's siphoned the water out of the Jordan to irrigate this beautiful land. And on the other side, the land of Jordan. They're both drawing water out of the River Jordan. And they estimate, somebody told me, I've heard different figures, within 200 years at the present rate, unless something is done to correct that, and there are all kinds of possible schemes being considered, in 200 years the Dead Sea will simply be a salt pit. It'll be empty of any water at all. The salt concentration of the Dead Sea averages around 31.5%. Now, that doesn't mean anything to people like me unless you know that salt water normally is 3.5%. And so the salt is so intense that it is called the Dead Sea for the good reason that it is dead. And one thing you will never see in the Dead Sea, and you did not see last week, is fishermen. There's nothing to fish. There's no fish, nor are there any sea plants there, just minuscule quantities of bacteria that do survive there, apparently, according to Wikipedia. But the amazing thing is that when this water from the temple touches the Dead Sea, it becomes fresh. This is as dramatic a picture of a well-known vision Ezekiel had in chapter 37, where he came upon a valley full of dry bones, and God said, "Can these bones live?" Well, they're all dead and dry. And Ezekiel is smart enough to give a good answer. He says, "Only God knows." That's a good way out of a question like that. But you remember how in that story, remarkably, God said to Ezekiel, "Speak to the dry bones." It's a very encouraging word to any preacher. I have to remind myself of that verse from time to time. Speak to the dry bones. And as he does so, God begins to breathe on them. And you remember the picture, tendons form, and then flesh, and then skin, and then life. And it's a picture of God's regenerative power. This is the same picture here. This water flowing into the Dead Sea, where everybody says, "There's nothing here. There's nothing here at all. It's dead." But when the water flowing from the temple flows in, it brings freshness and life. It's a beautiful picture of what God does in our lives, this picture of being fresh. You know, no matter how routine your life may be, no matter how predictable your life may of necessity have to be, and very often our lives are necessarily predictable and follow routines day after day and may even become dull, but the man, the woman, the boy, the girl who's in touch with God will be characterized by freshness in the middle of that. You know, Jeremiah, after the destruction of Jerusalem in 586, he walked through the rubble. Jeremiah had been taken off with the captives, and then he was given permission to go back to Jerusalem because he'd been telling everybody the Babylonians are going to conquer us, and the Babylonians thought that he had undermined their morale, and he was working in their favor, so they gave him permission to go back to Jerusalem. And he walks back to Jerusalem, and he writes the book of Lamentations. Have you read the book of Lamentations? Lamentations means weeping. And he walks through the rubble of the destroyed city of Jerusalem. He is weeping as he walks through it. And in chapter 3 and verse 22, Jeremiah writes this: "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And this is stated in the midst of the ultimate disaster for the people of Judah at the time. That their city destroyed, the temple demolished, and everybody taken off to Babylon. Jeremiah says, "But there's something which encourages me. And it's this, that God's mercies, his blessings are new every morning. They are fresh every morning." You see, we cannot live on stale blessings. We try to sometimes. Sometimes we come into a group like this, we come in on a journey like this, and we hope that we will recharge our spiritual batteries, and we'll go home and the little dial will say it's full, 100%, you know, and you go home and you'll live off this battery for the next 3 months and hope that you can still retain the blessings of these days. But it's not, the Christian life doesn't operate on that battery principle. It is the electricity principle, where you have to be plugged in to know the presence and power of what God wants to do in your life. And that is a daily thing. I remember when I was a young Christian, we used to go to some conferences where young people twice a year would come together for a weekend, Friday to Sunday, and we'd have lots of fun. They'd be teaching from the Word of God. And by Sunday night, we'd be leaving all excited, all charged up, you know. And I'd go home full of enthusiasm. I'd live off that for the next week or 10 days or 2 weeks and then creep back down and say, when's the next conference going to be? I got to go back and get charged up again. And then I made a discovery one day that Jesus Christ does not live in conferences. He lives in my heart. And his mercies are new every morning. You know, Job is one of the characters in the Bible who took a battering, as some of you have taken a battering in life. Job lost his business. Some of you might have experienced that. Job experienced the funerals of his children. Some of you have been there. His wife turned against him. I had an email this morning from somebody in Christian ministry. It's part of our church. And he said, my wife has asked me to leave, but they've had some difficulties. They've got two boys. That's a traumatic time. Job's wife turned against him. He turned for solace to his friends, and they simply heaped on him greater condemnation. Job, if things have gone wrong in your life, it's probably because you deserve it. That's a very logical way to think, you know. What do I do to deserve this? And they heaped condemnation on him. And then he went into such deep depression, he wished he'd never been born. He said, the day my father received news you have a son is a day I wish could be written out of history. And Job, in all this turmoil, says some very beautiful things. And one thing he says in Job 29, verse 19, is he says, my roots will reach to the water, and the dew will lie all night on my branches, and his glory will remain fresh in me. Isn't that incredible? Job, eventually, his body got sick as well, and sat in the ash heap, scratching himself with broken pottery. At least the ash heap was sterile. And he says, I want you to know this, that despite everything that's happening to me, my roots are reaching the water. And it remains fresh. God fed the Israelites in the wilderness for 40 years with manna, you remember. And when the manna first was given, he gave them clear instructions, take enough for the day only. Take it home and eat it. And it says, he who took too much didn't have too much. He who took too little didn't have too little. It was just enough. On the sixth day, take enough for the seventh day. But there were people amongst them, it says, who didn't want to come out every morning and collect the manna. And so they took home enough to last for the next 2 or 3 days. Probably found a cool place in the back of their tent, stuck it there. Why get up early in the morning to get the manna? We can have a lion and we can pull out yesterday's manna and we can eat it today. And when they tried to do that, it says in Exodus 16, verse 20, when they took out the manna, it was full of maggots and it began to stink. It raised the protein level a little bit. But you know, you can have a Christian experience that becomes full of maggots and begins to stink. If your spiritual diet is a meal on Sunday morning and that's it, and we don't spend time in communion with God and listening to God and speaking to God and consciously relating our lives to God as we go through each day, our Christian life will become very stale. When people say, as they listen to you know, I'm tired and bored with all this, that isn't surprising. Like any relationship, it depends on communication and intimacy of soul and heart to be nurtured and grow. And every day, God has something fresh, and this river brought freshness. I was speaking for a week on one occasion in Glasgow in Scotland. And a man came to talk to me one night and he said, you know, I was a Christian as a young man and I went away from God for 18 Yes. And I've been praying for the last 6 months that God will give me back what I had 18 years ago. I keep saying, God, give me back what I had, because I really had something that I felt was rich. Why isn't God giving it me back? I remember saying to him, you know, maybe you're asking for the wrong thing. Maybe God isn't the slightest interested in giving back what you had 18 years ago. Why don't you say instead, Lord Jesus, please be to me what I need you to be today. Please provide me today with that fresh sense of yourself. We can't recreate what God has done in the past. Too many have tried to do that. But the characteristic of this relationship with God is freshness, even in the stagnant Dead Sea. Where the water goes, it becomes fresh. It's a miracle of God. Second thing it brought was life. Verse 9 says, swarms of living creatures will live wherever the river goes. Of course, this is a characteristic of fresh water. It brings life. I remember on one occasion flying an aircraft over North India and looking down, I was in the window seat and it was all dry and barren down below. Hardly any sign of vegetation, hardly any sign of life. It was such a dry area. And I remember looking through the window where I was sitting and noticing a meandering green line coming across the landscape ahead of us. And as our aircraft slowly moved across and we came above that, I saw in the middle of it exactly what I expected to see in the middle of it, a river. And either side of the river, there was life. He says in verse 10, fishermen will stand along the shore from En-Gedi to En-Eglaim, and there'll be places for spreading nets. You know En-Gedi, of course, you went there the other day. That's near the Dead Sea where David hid from Saul, and the streams there are beautiful and fresh, and you may have swum in them, which means they won't be quite as fresh as they were, but normally beautiful water down there. And he says that where the stream has gone, it's become like the waters of En-Gedi. Fish live. You see, God is not just working in my life so that I have a nice, good, comfortable time, but that my life might become a means of life being spread to others. Some of you may have read some of Mark Buchanan's books. Mark Buchanan is a great writer. He, for a number of years, has been pastor of a church in Vancouver Island. He's now in Calgary as of the last few months. And Mark came to the People's Church in Toronto a year or so ago. And in one of his messages, he was contrasting the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, which Jeremiah and Ezekiel talk about and that Jesus talked about. And he pointed out that under the Old Covenant, diseases and uncleanliness was contagious. That's why you never touched a leper, because if you did, the disease may spread to you. It's a contagious disease. If something was unclean, there are lots of things in the book of Leviticus that are designated as unclean. If you touch it, you yourself become unclean. But he pointed out that with Jesus, it was completely reversed. When Jesus touched a leper, Jesus did not become a leper. The leper became clean. And that under the new covenant, it is cleanliness that becomes contagious. It is life that becomes contagious. And Ezekiel, who refers to the new covenant earlier in his prophecy, is describing it here, where the process is reversed. The stream going into the stagnant dead waters caused those waters to become alive and fresh. Rather than the stagnancy of the water contaminating the clean water. And that's why God places you and me in the situations he places, that our lives may be a source of enrichment and encouragement and blessing and life to other people. The narcissistic Christian life is just looking inside and introspective, and what's in it for me, and God bless me, and God look after me, and God give me this, and God give me that, and God give me the other thing. And this is the substance of our prayer life. Give me, give me, give me more, more, more. Amen. P.S. Give me more. When that becomes the nature of our Christian lives, we haven't begun to understand what God really wants to do, which is in working in us, that river flowing from us, will bring life as well as freshness. If I can quote Job again, remember Job's circumstances. And this is what he writes in Job 14, verse 8. Its roots may grow old in the ground, and its stump may die in the soil, yet at the scent of water, it will bud forth shoots like a young plant. Oh, a beautiful picture. The roots have grown old. The stump is dying. Maybe that's how you feel about yourself sometimes. At the scent of water, put your roots into the water. It'll bud and put forth shoots. That's Job chapter 14 and verse 8. The third thing the river brought was fruit. Verse 12, fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both banks of the river. This word fruit is a familiar one to the readers of the New Testament. It talks frequently about fruit and fruitfulness and fruit bearing. Colossians 1 verse 10, Paul says, we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God. What pleases God? He says, bearing fruit. Fruit is that which is produced by the life. That having been recipients of the life of God as he comes to indwell us, he produces his fruit. So in John 15 and verse 5, and in a few minutes, we're going to have our reflection on based on John 15. In John 15, verse 5, Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Here's the picture. I'm a vine, you're the branch. The branch is utterly dependent on the vine. Now it says, if you remain in the vine, or some translation, you abide in the vine, and the vine abides in you, there is that mutual interdependence of the vine and the branches together, you will bear fruit. But without me, you produce nothing. If the connection of the vine to the branch is poor, there'll be no fruit. That's why he gives it to them as a responsibility. Abide in me. I think we can sum up the Christian life in a couple of simple invitations that Jesus gave to people in the Gospels. The first is, come to me. That's the initial stage. The second is, abide in me. Live in fellowship with me, in dependence upon me. And the result will be fruitfulness. John 15, verse 8, Jesus said, this is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. It's the evidence of the real thing. John 15, verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Paul in Philippians 1, verse 11, speaks of being filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ. Righteousness is simply the character of God, and the character of God, which is the fruit of Jesus Christ living in us by his Holy Spirit. And you'll be familiar with Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. 9 characteristics that Paul gives there as the fruit of the Spirit, and we can reduce them to one word. The fruit of the Spirit is character, love, joy, peace, etc. By the way, and I sometimes point this out, it's important to point this out, these are the fruit of the Spirit, not the flowers of the Spirit. And there is a difference. I think sometimes we think of these as being flowers. You see, flowers make a place look nice. If the place is a bit droopy, just put up a few flowers. These are not the flowers of the Spirit that make Christians nice people. You know, it's nice to have Christian neighbors because they don't keep parking their vehicle in front of your house. They don't play their music at full volume at 1 o'clock in the morning. Well, maybe they do, but, you know, it's nice when they don't. They're polite when they meet you outside. It's good to employ Christians because they start work on time and they don't leave early and they don't cheat. I mean, all that's fine, but that is not what this is about. Those are simply being flowers. What is fruit for? Fruit has an altogether different function. Fruit is not decorative. Fruit is not to make the place nice. Fruit is for consumption, for eating. You don't say, this place is a bit drab. Why don't we hang up a few bananas? That won't help. Now you say, I'm hungry. Can I have a banana? Would somebody give me an apple? And when the scripture speaks about fruit flowing out of our lives, it's that which feeds hungry people, the people who are hungry for our love, the people who are hungry for our patience, hungry for our kindness, our goodness, our gentleness, our faithfulness, our self-control, hungry to experience the peace within us that will spread out to them, as being with somebody who's at peace does. This is the fruit. And so this river that flows out of the temple gets deeper the further it goes, gets wider the further it goes, begins as a leak and right of the temple. You don't see anything of this. You don't see what it's going to be doing. Don't try to measure how much is happening through your life. Just trust God to be looking after the consequences as you live in obedience and dependence upon him and in fellowship with him. But where that river goes, it'll come into the stagnant waters of a dead sea and bring freshness. It'll bring life all the way down. It'll bring fruit. It will feed hungry people. And I finish with the key to this. It's in chapter 47, verse 12, where it says, fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both banks of the river. Their leaves will not wither, nor will their fruit fail. Every month they will bear fruit. Listen to this. Because the water from the sanctuary flows to them. Their water will serve for food and their leaves for healing. The key is, it is the water from the sanctuary. That is the temple that flows to them. What is going on in the sanctuary? What is going on in the temple? Four chapters earlier, Ezekiel has met a man who said, Ezekiel, this is the place of my throne. This is the place of the soles of my feet where I have occupied territory. And as Ezekiel observes, the glory of the Lord filled the temple. The presence of God was real and central. And the result was that what flows out of that life, that temple, that building, as the picture being what flows out of our lives will be fresh, life-giving, and fruit-bearing. You know, we don't have this retreat and these Bible studies just because it's the respectable thing to do on a Christian journey like this. But because our desire is that we meet with God, we hear his voice through his word, we interact with him, Not that we go home with more information. We go home with a lot more information than which we came. We've heard so much from our guides. But we go home experiencing transformation. A greater yieldedness to the Lord Jesus Christ, a greater love for Him, a greater dependence upon Him, a greater sense of our need for His fullness within us. That this be the place of His throne, the place where He occupies territory, that out of our hearts will flow a river of life-giving water. I'm going to lead you in prayer, and it may well be that there are some of us here this morning, and over the years, maybe over recent months, maybe through a particular event, you know that you've wandered away from a relationship that is living and fresh and real, and God has moved to the circumference of your life rather than being at the center. And I want us to spend a moment in silent prayer. And it may be some of us need to just simply pray quietly in our own hearts a prayer that says, Lord Jesus, take the throne of my life. Take the throne. Fill me with your glory, your presence. And flow out of my life a river that's going to bring fruit and life and freshness. Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you for every man and woman in this place today. We're motivated to be here because we want to explore and discover things concerning yourself. But I pray, Lord Jesus, that where you become simply a set of bullet points in our minds, this is what we believe. But we become detached from a living, fresh experience of yourself, that you'll bring us back home to know you, to be loved by you, to experience you. That Christianity becomes so much more than our theology. It becomes life. It becomes fresh. And it becomes fruitful. Make this real, we pray, in all of our lives. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation.
Tune in next week for another message from Charles Price.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given. Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given. Jesus Christ.
of what the Lord has done for us.
And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us.
Give thanks.
Give thanks. Give thanks with a grateful heart.
Give thanks to the Holy One.
Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son.
And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am strong.